Before you listen to this BBC podcast, I'd like to introduce myself. My name's Stevie Middleton, and I'm a BBC commissioner for a load of sport podcasts. I'm lucky to do that at the BBC because I get to work with leading journalists, experienced pundits, and the biggest sports stars. Together, we bring you untold stories and fascinating insights straight from the players' mouths. But the best thing about doing this at the BBC is our unique access to the sporting world. What that means is that we can bring you podcasts that create a real connection to dedicated sports fans across the UK. So if you like this podcast, head over to BBC Sounds where you'll find plenty more.
BBC Sounds. Music, radio, podcasts.
Hi, and welcome to another Midnight Meets. Thank you so much for listening to this podcast, wherever it is. Just a 1 hour of 10 hours and more throughout the week on weeknights and Five Live, 10:30 p.m. to 1 a.m. Now, I know there's dozens and dozens of Midnight Meets to listen to, and you'll have your favourites, but this one is definitely one of mine. Tom Chaplin, probably best known as being the lead singer of Keane. He's got a new solo album coming out now. But it made for an interesting chat for many reasons, which you hear in the interview right from the very beginning in terms of proximity. But when Hopes and Fears went stratospheric, their debut album, I was on Radio 1 and interviewed them. Didn't think I was a kid when I was in my 20s, but I know now I was. And all these years later, you know, nearly 20 years later, coming back together with someone who I interviewed so much back then, and sort of having that perspective maybe of a bit of age and wisdom, made it for a really interesting and I think a very warm and honest chat. And I think it's I'm really glad you've listened to this one. It will not let you down. So this is our Midnight Meets with Tom Chaplin from Keane.
You'll follow me back with the sun in your eyes.
Tom Chaplin, welcome to Midnight Meets.
Hello.
This is, you're a first, and I'll tell you why you're a first. We've been doing this for over a year.
Mm-hmm.
So there's about 60, 65 long form interviews on Midnight Meets available to listen to. None of them have been face to face because of COVID and restrictions. Oh. So could I start with a hug? Just because I haven't had any human contact for so long.
Bring it in.
Have it here. Yes. Oh. It's just... the things we take for granted. And there it is.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, I was talking to someone about this earlier on, how with COVID, you know, it suddenly became, that felt like the new normal. And it's very strange how quickly you can get used to thinking, oh, this is how it's always going to be. And mercifully, we did come out the other side of it. And now it's a relief to remember.
Yeah.
Just the number of freedoms that we do have.
It could never be regular. It had to be irregular. And I remember that phrase, new normal, started, and we had mental health experts in the show saying, don't use the phrase. Like, this is yeah. not normal, and don't ever let it be normal, because yeah. we'll go to hell in a handcart if that's yeah. normal, you know?
Yeah.
So listen, our chat, it's not going to follow any chronology, because I don't think it needs to. And
sure.
And also the death knell for any interview with any musician is, let's start with a new album that not many people have heard yet. But actually, it's the only place to start, because actually it just will trickle back to right. so many other things anyway, sure. past and future. So I want to do that.
Yeah.
It's called Midpoint. It's funny, I write the names of the track down and then little mm-hmm. notes. So I've got it for each song. But I actually had to go back and write down the name of the first track when I checked through my notes, because like subconsciously I just wrote wow. Huh. You know, because the first line hit me right between the eyes. A very emotive album, and I'll probably get a word wrong here, but it's whisper if you're in the wind, swallowed by the world, tell me if you're struggling to climb out of the hole.
Correct.
Right?
Yes.
It's such a powerful on the nose lyric. In one hand, I thought this is a love letter to one person, but then it kind of feels like it's aimed at the listener as well, more generically aimed at anybody who wants to listen to this album, a stranger who you make that musical connection with. And I suppose that in many ways is what music is.
Yeah.
So, I got so many meanings out of that first line.
Yeah, I agree. I think it was actually one of the songs that came out of the lockdown experience, probably the only one that was kind of really influenced by being in lockdown. And that sense of, and also the album is about getting older and having more experience of life. And obviously I've seen some real highs and some crushing lows in my life. And I think the thing when you're in a bad place is that you think there's no way out and I'll never find a way out. And I suppose the song is just trying to say to that person, whoever it is, could even be me in the past, but, you know, it's saying, just hang tight. It will be okay. If you see this through, you will be okay. And there are people out there who love you and will support you. You know, I think that's often the thing. When you see people jump up on social media and say, I'm going to take my own life, which you do see a lot these days.
Yeah.
The number of people that rush and say, you're so loved, you're so wanted, get in touch, you know, make a connection. You know, it reminds us of that. So I sort of wanted to try and touch on those things. And I mean, you know, for an opening song, it is, yeah, it's trying to sort of draw the listener in.
We all fall down. Yeah, we all fall down. If you're sinking like a storm, maybe I can slow you down. I can show you how to find your way back home.
Stars Align is a lovely song. It's got a great chorus. And again, the reason why I jumped to that is people will write in abstract about mental health and about struggles. This album doesn't. A lot of the lyrics are so straight at you of like, that is what I've been through and this is what I've learned from it, and that this is how bad it was and this is how good it's been. And this is a weird thing to say to anyone. I find a lot of the lyrics therapy based.
Yes.
As in, like, I can hear the therapist. I can hear that. Right. And I'm not going to get into individual trauma, and that's not, I would never do that. But I can hear the sessions in some of the lyrics.
Yeah. Yes, that's the way I've written my solo albums. They've been a kind of way of documenting those sessions, really, ultimately, because that's where I'm at my most candid, or I'm completely candid with my therapist. Nothing escapes that situation. It's all laid out there on the table.
Open, I'm waiting, and I'm taking back the moment.
Organizing that stuff, it's processing those feelings, is learning about who I am and who other people in my life are. And so of course for me, that sort of openness and all of the stuff that gets talked about now, I find it so interesting. And it, of course, as soon as I get then start to write, it's like, well, it's all channeled into the writing. It's just an inevitability. And people often say to me, oh, you know, how can you seem very honest with this album. It doesn't strike me that it's being particularly honest. It's just, that's the way I do things.
No, you are very honest. You are very honest in interviews, and you're very open when you talk about things. But you also, which is a trick I learned very early, you hide in plain sight. So you go, this is all the big things that happened, but don't ask me about why it happened. Don't ask me about what got there. And that's, I like that. You protect the trauma a bit, and that's good.
Yeah.
And you should do.
Yep.
And this is a generic question on that, and I'm respecting that boundary. But with therapy, you're there, say, a year, right? Then you're there 2 years, then you're there 3 years. Did you work out that your therapist knew on day one or day three what the problem was, but waited? Part of the skill is waiting until that moment that your mind can handle it. Because therapy does help.
A good question.
Because therapy helps, but it's a very dangerous process. Because every time you think you've achieved something, you realise the next jump on your horse race of life is bigger. So therapy brings breakthroughs, but it brings depression because the enormity keeps growing. Because the therapist knows on day one, I'm convinced therapists know when you sit down. It's your dad, it's your mum, it's the da-da-da, whatever. And they could point at you and say it, but your literal head would explode all over the room.
Right.
Well, this makes sense.
I know exactly what you mean. And it's very interesting what you say, because when I first went to see my therapist, this was in 2009 or 10, so a long time ago. And I went with a kind of existential crisis, which is what I was having at that point in my life. I was in my 30s or whatever, and I was like, oh, what happens when we die? Why are we all here? You know, all the questions that you can't answer, and there's no point in spending time trying to answer them. And with a load of very vivid dreams that I was having at the time. And my wife, who was training to be a psychotherapist herself at that time, said, this guy has come into lecture and he is amazing. You know, all the students are in awe of him, and he's a psychoanalyst.
Yeah.
So she said, you should get in touch with him because of these dreams and blah, blah, blah. So I went to him thinking that was my problem, my existential crisis, blah, blah, blah. And it was interesting because as the therapy progressed, as I began to trust him and tell him things I'd never told anyone else before, my drug use got worse and worse and worse. And it's interesting what you say about it bringing on a depression. I think I had to go through those times as part of the process.
Yeah. And again, so because I want to play another bit of music. Colourful Light has a line, myrrh, don't cry. I can't say the word myrrh, I've butchered your lyric. Myrrh, don't cry, all I know is stirring back. I always say that phrase is really, really trite. Anyone who's been through, everybody's been through. It's not anyone, it's everyone to varying extents. And if you haven't, it's coming. But the reflection in your worst moments is sometimes the hardest thing. So that lyric was really personal. I felt like that's a direct reference to a night. That's a direct reference to rock bottom. Right. Because I think we've had that where we've looked in the mirror and when it stirs back, there's a truth to it, isn't there?
I think that song, I was trying to sum up a kind of ambivalence that I have about myself, you know, in that I've done so much work to try and learn to like myself, but I'm also gripped by self-loathing, you know, from time to time. Mm. And that can eat away at me and can bring me depression and, you know, bouts where I just feel rubbish about myself. But also there is a flip side to that, you know, and I think the song isn't, it's not just a kind of, it's not sort of purely about self-loathing. It's also about the other side of that, which is that I think in our lives, very often we are the sum total of all of our experiences. And actually, you know, coming out of depression or addiction, I don't regret any of it. I don't wish away any of that stuff because it's made me who I am. And I suppose the song is about I'm a more colourful, more interesting person because of that stuff. Mm. So I wanted to try and sum that up in that song. Oh, I'm still daring to dream. That's the trouble with me. In my reflection spectrum come alive through the prism of my heartbreak, rays of colorful light.
I get that. I think the other part of that is the things that cause it have to be forgiven, and that's partly forgiving yourself for what you put other people through, like your wife and your kid when your kid was born. That's me just being honest, right?
I'm not
criticising you for
right,
it. Addiction
right.
is a horrible thing when it kicks in. But then also forgiving those that you go, actually, through my therapy, I know that whether for you, I'm not, I don't want to know, but I'm saying whether for you it was boarding school or whether, you know, for me it was a broken home or whatever it was.
Yeah.
You then have to forgive the things around, and that's kind of really difficult. That's really, that's the onion, isn't it? being pulled back.
Indeed.
So much of that to talk about, right? And as I say, people listening to this Midnight Meets with Tom Chaplin would be like, you've started with a new album. You never do that. This is why. This ties in everything. It's a beautifully honest record. I like any record. There's tracks I love and there's tracks I don't. That's a record, right?
Yeah.
Midpoint, the title track. I like it when you're sparse. I don't think you're sparse enough. I never thought Keane were sparse enough.
Yeah.
You know, moments like Bed Shaped, where you were like, do this more, right?
Yeah.
You know.
You'll follow me back with the sun in your eyes.
What I mean is, like, the artist's temptation is to layer and add.
Mm.
But you do sparse beautifully. Midpoint is a great example of the title track. It's desolate and it's... I mean, this is the cornerstone of the record, I suppose, which is you're 43, I'm 45. And you say, I'm on my way back down.
Yeah.
You know, the idea...
I'm over half the way back down.
The idea it's going to get easier when you go down the other side of the mountain. Are we kidding ourselves?
Like, I don't know about that. I think it's more about having peaked, I suppose, was what I'm trying to say with that.
No, I'm the opposite. I think life's got to get better.
Well, that's the thing. The message of the song is... the song itself is a journey. It's a journey from melancholic and reflective and worrying about having this sort of sense of... kind of losing that youthful vigor and passion that inevitably goes when you reach a certain point in life. But also the song is a journey in a direction, which is actually, I can now, you know, knowing myself better, knowing what I like, having this little world that I love and appreciating that in a much better way, I'm actually able to enjoy it more. Mm. So the song actually ends with, you know, the line, what is it? While standing tall, salute the wonder of it all.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, about just being kind of deferential and saying, wow, it's amazing to be alive.
While standing tall, salute the wonder of it all. While standing tall, salute the wonder of it all.
Here's a question you'll get asked in any other interview. Do you think there is happiness, or do you think we kind of fool ourselves when we're younger? And then when we get to our age, and there'll be people listening to this older than us that'll be like, yeah, you're finally cutting it on. Do you think we should be looking for contentment in our everyday? Like, just getting up in the morning, going to bed at night, there's an existentialism to this, but like, to go to bed at night and think the little thing made it worthwhile being on this earth today. I was a good person today, rather than looking for the car and the house and the perfect family and no addictions and no flaws and no failures. It feels to me like an impossible dream for every human being on the planet.
Yeah.
So I think I look for contentment more now than happiness.
Yes, absolutely. Well, happiness is fleeting, isn't it?
Mm.
And it's visited upon us, you know, from time to time. But as soon as you realise that's the state you're in, it's gone.
Yeah.
But I think you're right. Contentment and fulfillment, knowing what it is that makes you content or might bring you occasional happiness, learning what those things are is just so crucial, isn't it?
The lyric of New Flowers, there's too many earth references in this album. If I'd have been editor, I would have taken a couple out. There's one about the rivers flowing to the sea.
Right.
Didn't like that lyric. What song's that in? The river flowing to the sea or the river. Anyway, I didn't like that reference.
Okay.
But then New Flowers got me. Right? New Flowers got me because it's brilliant. I don't need no fast life on the road. I just want to savour my time getting old. Again, it's this crushing honesty that you do that maybe you don't give yourself enough credit for it. Oh, I do love that lyric.
Yeah.
And I like how, again, it's just you kind of just open up the petals and go there, pardon the pun, and you just go, there it is. There's a really plain, honest thought I have now. Talk me through that song.
Well, that's a song about my kids, really, and about sort of accepting that they are the next generation, and my time of being a kind of young, thrusting, cool demographic or whatever, that's gone. Right, and I think that's a lot. That's one of the hardest things about this point in life is that you have to mourn the loss of your youth.
Yeah.
And one of the biggest problems that people have is that they try and recreate it. It's like, oh, I must get it back. You know, and that's the whole driving force behind the fast car or the going out with a new younger partner.
Yep.
Or wanting to spend more time in the pub or whatever it might be. It's often that's the driving force. It's trying to recapture something that's gone. And you have to mourn it. You have to say, it's gone. And then the question is, well, what are you happy with now? Mm. And of course, when I look out at my life, it's like, well, it's seeing my kids, it's watching them grow and watching them become beautiful little individuals and being able to enjoy that. So the song is about that. It's about saying, you know, my time of being out on the road and trying to kind of impress people by standing on a big stage, that's more or less over.
Yeah.
And it's time to enjoy things more vicariously.
Yeah. The last song on the album is a proper final song. It's called Overshoot. It's a proper love song.
Sometimes I feel like I could run wild, tear the fabric of our love, cut and run from the world that we've been building, but I've...
So as I say, throughout the album, you like to take very big imagery.
Yeah.
You like to take oceans and you like to take mountains and you like to take the earth and you like to take all of that, for better or for worse, you take a lot of that.
Yeah.
This isn't. This feels like a real love letter to your wife, Natalie, isn't it?
Natalie, yeah.
This feels like, what an end of the record, by the way. How it finishes is, it could only be the last record.
Yeah. It's sparse enough for you, this one.
This is sparse enough for me. Yeah. Don't overdo it. If I mastered this, I'd be losing a lot. Nobody joking. But talk me through that, because that felt like it, unlike what I said about the first track in the album, this felt like it was just aimed directly, bang, there you go.
Yeah, well, it's a love song with experience. Like, I think that's the thing. It's about, you know, with this record, I didn't want to try... It's that thing of recapturing something.
Yeah.
Like, I know there are certain... I can think of certain contemporaries of mine, bands, for example, who are maybe collaborating with young artists or working with certain writers in order to still appeal to a certain demographic. Mm. And personally, I can't handle that. I'd much rather hear them writing about something that feels pertinent to their current point in life. Mm. And, you know, this Overshoot is a kind of love song that could only be born out of the experience of being with someone for nearly 20 years, which is what I've been with my wife. And so it's a song about the doubt that inevitably creeps in because you've been together for so long and you kind of take each other for granted, or it doesn't have the same kind of fiery sense of passion that it did when you first started out. The nature of your relationship changes in a way, especially when you've got kids, it becomes more of a, you know, you're more of a partnership as well. But again, it's a thing that needs to be adapted to. And again, on the other side of it, I think is something very beautiful, recognising what you have with each other, that kind of language that you have, which is born out of the history that you have and just the stuff that you've experienced together that no one else would understand, right? I mean, if I divorced my wife and started with someone new, there'd be none of that. There'd be none of that shared history. And there's something very beautiful about that, worth, like, clinging on to. So the song is saying, I hope for the second part of lives we're able to do that until the ship goes down.
With a little luck, when the lights go up and the ship goes down, we'll be dancing. With a little luck, when the lights go up and the ship goes down, we'll be hand in hand.
Your voice is better now. Mm. Is it better now than Hopes and Fears? Probably. It's certainly better trained. But I also just feel like it's in a better nick. And that's rare. You sort of get into your 40s, it usually starts going south, and you see artists live, they start cutting the notes off or getting the crowd to sing the high notes. It seems to be going a bit the other way with you. You've got a lot more control over it. There's bits of it are a bit Tom Yorky, there are bits of it very you. There's introductions, and even musically as well, the progression for you, a little bit of Tom Waits in the opening bits of songs. I can hear a little bit of Big in Japan here and that type of thing, you know. So I mean, you're always going to say you're most proud of your new record. Most of the times that's bullshit when artists say that. But there's probably is a genuine claim here, because I think the artistry and the vocal is probably at its best.
Well, the interesting thing for me is that it was all recorded pretty much live. So everything vocally, that was one of the great thrills of working with Ethan Johns, who produced the record. He does things in a very old-fashioned way, which is to get all the musicians in a room and actually record everything live to tape. Mm. And then he takes the best 7 or 8 takes, and he might cut a few together, or he might just use one take. And of course, so every time that you're there, it's a performance. Mm. And it's like, this could be the one.
Yeah.
It gives a whole different flavor to a record, which because normally when it comes to doing vocals, you make the whole album, you layer it up bit by bit, and you get to the end of it and it's like, right, let's do all the vocals now.
Yeah.
Well, where's the soul in doing that?
Correct.
Right. You know, so
correct.
Doing it this way was a real thrill, like I say. But I don't think you can do it unless you have confidence in your instrument. So I think 15, 20 years ago, I wouldn't have been able to do it this way. So, yeah, now was the right time to make a record like that. And I think you're right. I think my voice probably is kind of, it's got a richness now. And as you say, probably I've got a control over it that I never really had in the past.
I feel like there's a mentality in Britain that we kind of write off solo albums by lead singers of bands who were or are huge. Like it automatically stuff. Because like I can listen to this album and then put it up against, say, Perfect Symmetry or Strange Land, probably pull out more singles of this.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Like I can go, that'd be a hit. That would be. But then it's almost like the next side of it, the promo side of it.
Yeah.
You almost have to justify the relevance. Whereas I feel in America when like Bruce Springsteen brings out an album, everyone bows at his feet still.
Mm.
You know, when Neil Young brings out an album, everyone bows at his feet when Tom Waits does. Whereas here, it seems to be a little bit reverse. I don't know why.
I don't know why, but I think what you say is bang on. But I'm not sure of the reason why. I suppose we're quite fickle. I mean, I remember with Keane, even by Hopes and Fears was obviously a massive record. And then we followed it up with Under the Iron Sea, which was obviously a much darker record, born out of a much darker place.
Yeah.
And it divided the fans of Hopes and Fears. But and then it was almost like, because we did that, that time of being at that sort of peak that Hopes and Fears created was gone. And it was the next cab off the rank, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I don't know. I think certainly in this country, to sustain that level, you have to work unbelievably hard. You have to have almost kind of sociopathic desire to stay there.
Mm.
And we certainly didn't have that.
No.
And we were so disorganized, you know, chaotic. And certainly I was so chaotic as a human being that was never going to happen anyway.
You kept it all very quiet, like all the way through. Because Edith and I weren't really one at the time when Hopes and Fears came out. And you kept that all very quiet, as you do. And that's kind of the key point that ties in this album and the very first Keane album. Could you imagine having the conversation that we've just had when you were a kid and I was a kid?
No way!
It sums up the whole midpoint thing,
it totally does, yeah.
Like, and I wouldn't have asked you the right question. And you wouldn't have given me the right answer.
No.
We just didn't talk like that. Like, praise the Lord. I'm not religious, but you'll praise whatever Lord you worship or don't, that we do this now.
Yeah.
Two men who were so far behind women in a million ways can at least sort of drag ourselves towards a conversation like this.
Yeah. I think that's partly the age we're at, but also the nature of the conversation has changed, hasn't it? I mean, I remember when I first went into rehab.
Mm.
In 2006 or 2007, maybe. Mm-hmm. And the sort of, there was so much kind of scoffing and belittling of me being there in the red tops and wherever, or even just at that point, sort of early social media. It was so cruel. And these days, people just would never even dare to behave like that towards someone with mental health problems, which is essentially what it is. Yeah. So it's nice that the conversation has started to shift.
Still think some of them do. I still see
probably
some, still see some headlines and I'm like, I can't believe. I want to talk a bit about the first record then, going from all the way from last to first, I think it's not a bad thing to do.
Yeah.
you know, I liked it at the time. You know it did, because we did interviews and stuff. But it stood the test of time. Mm. You know, it kind of sits out as one of the ugly ducklings, because it's in the top 50 best-selling albums in the UK ever. Yeah. Right, so it's 37 now. It slipped down. It's 36. Yeah. Eventually, it'll be out. But it's in the top 50 now. And we get that the Beatles are in there several times. We get the Pink Floyd. Right? Mm. We get the Madonnas in there and Michael Jackson. And then there's two or three that just go, oh, and there it is. Yeah. Right? And then you go, right, so sales, it doesn't mean great record. It doesn't mean longevity. It could be of its time, because there's some albums in there were of their time I wouldn't listen to now. But I still listen to it.
Yeah.
The greatest thing about that record is it lives still. I can, you know, and it you could just be so proud of that as a debut album.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, totally. Yeah. I mean, it's a, I don't think we quite knew what we had created. Mm. I mean, I think that might have been part of the problem for us. Mm. You know, I remember going in to play a few songs at Island Records before it came out. Nick Gatfield, who was the big head honcho at that point, he said, everyone, this is Keane, and by early next year, they're going to have a number one record, and we expect them to have sold a million albums, blah, blah. We actually fell about laughing, which was, you know, in the context of all the people from the label being there, was probably not the right thing to do. But I don't think we realised, you know, how good those songs were. And then, of course, how they then translated. And we just see, I remember Tim saying, you know, there were B-sides that he wrote at that time that probably would have been singles on later records. You know, the songs were just absolutely flowing out of him.
I get why you wouldn't have had that expectations, because it was an album written during, you know, right back to like playing covers in pubs, through the name change, through to then dropping the cherry so it's only Keane, and then like, so they weren't written with expectation, I don't think. As such, a lot of them, because the album's almost fully formed when you get signed, as far as I remember.
Yeah, yeah.
It's hardly any, you know, most bands get signed, then they go in, and the pressure's on. Well, you kind of had it there.
Yeah.
So the songs weren't, you know, written with the advance or written with the deal.
No, but I think what had happened is that because we'd been living in London for quite a few years, and we'd been trying and trying and trying, and we hadn't really kind of worked out what we were best at. And then our guitarist left and Tim went to play the piano, which is what he always wrote songs on. Mm. So that was a kind of, you know, happy accident or an unconscious move anyway. But for whatever reason, he was playing the piano. That then formed the sound. At the same time, my voice kind of came into its own. And I think also we realised that, you know, I was writing songs at that point. Dominic, the guitarist, had been writing songs. Mm. But I think we all realised that Tim's probably a cut above the rest.
Right.
And he really channeled so much energy into his writing, and I channeled so much energy into the singing. Mm. And suddenly it was just it was just sort of alchemy, I suppose, at the time for us.
Said that Tim at his best as a songwriter you couldn't get near.
Yeah.
Was a quote from way back, a decade ago or something.
Yeah.
Do you get, and this would be arrogant, but like the other thing in Britain is we never like to sound inconfident, so don't just say it.
Right. Yeah,
does Midpoint get closer to him for you?
It gets closer. I mean, I think, you know, I've still not written a song that's as good as Tim's best songs. That would be my feeling. Although I can't put, I'm not really going to be the judge of that. I mean, this has been a problem for me. I think this is part of the reason I didn't do any writing for so long, was that I'd sit down at the piano or with the guitar, and I'd immediately have him in my head and be comparing myself to him. And I think, obviously, another thing that's been good about therapy is just learning that I'm all right. I can do these things. I can, you know, and I can talk about myself, and it doesn't have to be in league with or compared with someone else. You know, it just can be my own thing. And I think the more I realise that, the better the songs I write get.
And your mate, you remember him writing songs like when you were 5 or 6, and he's writing song stuff. Yeah. And is he always just going to be the big brother? Like, is he always going to be the Noel? Like, because I know it's stupid to say when you're now 43 and 46 or whatever it is, but have you ever kind of never really, you're always going to be the little one, I reckon, in that.
Yeah,
that
it's very hard to shift that dynamic, isn't it? I mean, McCartney said that about George Harrison. He's, just my baby brother, you know.
Yes.
It's like, you know, and I think that probably annoyed George a lot. But is it, so those dynamics, they're set in stone at such a young age. And it's very hard to sort of change that or recalibrate that. And so, yes, I mean, I think Tim and I have a very complicated friendship.
Yeah.
Like, he finds it like almost impossible to write for anyone other than me in mind.
Yeah.
Almost like I'm his muse or something. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? And like, if I say, oh, I want to go away and make a solo record, I think it wounds him. It like, he feels like, you know, like he's not able to do anything.
Yeah.
But yes. And I think, but I sort of also, I envy him so much. Mm. I mean, I think we envy each other a lot, but I certainly envy him. I envy his songwriting and his kind of artistry, and I want it, you know. But it's probably part of what also makes that relationship work as well.
Obviously, you say you don't go back, you don't change anything, right? There can't be much you remember, you know, from the first couple of albums. So, like, that. So people always assume success equals a happiness and equals, like, I was on top of the world.
Mm.
But I've interviewed so many really successful bands and artists who, when they really get into the interview and they really open up, say, I didn't enjoy it. Mm. I didn't like it. I was constantly had a fast heartbeat.
Yeah.
You know, whether it was through drugs or whether it was just through panic.
There's not much oxygen up there, is it?
No,
that's the
right?
thing. And I think it requires so much energy to keep yourself in that place. It's an addiction of sorts, isn't it? Yeah, I definitely would agree with that. That's it, being rich and famous and adored and having the number one albums. None of that stuff really cured the problem. It might have kind of given me temporary relief from what was killing me inside, but only temporary. And I think that what I realised was all of those things are external fixes, aren't they? The number one albums, the adoring fans, the money, whatever it might be. It's looking outwards into the world and saying, what can the world provide me with to make me feel happy? And of course, you know, and I'm not just talking about bands, this is for everyone probably, but the accumulation of stuff, it never really satisfies that itch that is inside you. So for me, what I've learned is the inward journey has been the thing that's given me, well, has alleviated the pain in the end. It's exploring it, it's meeting it head on. Yes, I mean, that would always be my recommendation to anyone. It's like, don't look out into the world for the answers. You look inside yourself. I mean, I know it's a sort of cheesy thing to say, but it's definitely true.
Did you then? Because the thing with Under the Iron Sea is here you're kicking in to 3 million album sales worldwide. But there was probably a very steep decline in that because the tour ended, the US tour got cancelled, you're going to rehab. Do you ever think about, like, was that kind of the moment where you took a left turn away from world domination? Like, do you know what I mean? Because it literally was bang, stop.
Yep. Well, I think it probably did really harm us. I think what I said about earlier on about Under the Iron Sea being a much less commercial record, fewer love songs, more just darker. I mean, I think that probably didn't help. People always used to compare us to Coldplay, which you know,
piano.
And still do. Piano and emotions or something like that.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's very superficial comparison. But what I thought was always interesting was that we did gigs with them and we were good friends with them. Tim and Chris were great friends because they were at university together. Tim almost even joined Coldplay.
Didn't he turn him down?
I think, well, I'm not sure quite the details. I think he wanted to do Keane and wanted to do his own thing. I just remember Chris, right from the start, he just had a look in his eye that said world domination. You know, and there's even footage of them in the early days, isn't there, saying we're going to be the biggest band in the world. And I can see how that's happened. And he just keeps driving it forwards. And some days I sit around and I think, God, you know, if we just made a slightly different record than Under the Iron Sea, if we'd made more of a Rush of Blood to the Head, which was more of a kind of sort of capitalizing on Parachutes, which is what they did.
Yes.
You know, if we'd done that and if I'd been sober and happier and more committed to the cause, blah, blah, blah. Of course, you know, all that whataboutery. But I do definitely entertain and sometimes even indulge that as a thought.
Yeah, but not to be morbid, if you hadn't made that record, you'd be dead in a hotel room, right? Possibly.
Possibly,
Because this was a massive off the cliff. And I know therapy meant more than the rehab, but you still needed at that moment to not be taking drugs.
Yeah.
You know, disappearing for 3 days. So, like, I don't know about that. I would expel that thought because...
Oh, I generally do expel it.
Let's mention your kids because, like, you know, it happens for a reason. I hate that. I don't buy into that. Yeah. Things are... Yeah. Just coincidences that all clash into each other.
Yeah.
But yeah, I wouldn't chase that at all.
Yeah.
That thought, because actually you needed to be where you had to go back to a different place.
Yeah.
You know?
I think if I watch, like, you know, if I see, like, sort of, it comes back to envy, doesn't it?
Yeah.
If I see sort of footage of Coldplay playing Five Nights at Wembley and they're absolutely smashing it and, you know, and it's just an amazing spectacle. And I think there's a part of me that thinks, you bastards. I could have been there. That could have been me, you know, if we'd worked harder and done blah, blah, blah. So I'm aware. I think that's the thing. As long as you can step outside of yourself and say, oh, look, you're being envious.
Yes.
You know, that's fine. You can move past it. But you're right. If you allow that stuff to take over, then you're on a very dangerous path.
And this is the thing about Keane, every album went into number one. So apart from the last one, which got scuppered a bit by COVID, but still went to number two. I'm guessing you were happier when you sold 200,000 copies, you know, of Strangeland. Or you sold over 100,000 copies in the US of Perfect Symmetry. That was for a British band, it's great. Right? Was that just moments of that? I know there were, again, ups and downs there.
Yeah.
But were there just moments of being able to stop and smell the flowers, pardon the pun?
Well... Under the Iron Sea was very dark. Perfect Symmetry, that was a period of life where I got back into partying, but in a way that didn't involve cocaine, but involved other things.
Yeah.
And actually, I was able to hold it together. And so there was an exuberance to that time that we carried through. Strangeland, things started to go a bit south again. Tim's marriage got on the rocks, and obviously that's a lot of that album came out of that. But actually, I mean, I think probably Strangeland is up there with the best of the Keane albums. I think it's got some amazing songs on it. It's just like somehow went under the radar a bit.
It comes back to the thing of how long a band are about, I think.
Yeah, yeah. But I think that album merits of a bit of revisiting and celebrating, because whenever we play live, there's always a load more songs from Strangeland than, well, probably Hopes and Fears and Strangeland are the two songs that sort of comprise the live set.
What happens with Keane? You have these intense, low, unbreakable relationships, which means that you aren't as urgent about it as fans are. Like, you don't have to be. There's always an end of the phone or the WhatsApp group, or, like, you know, so you don't need to do that. It's like, you know, you don't need to tell your brother you love him, type thing. Like, because you could, this whole thing now, right? The key is, like, wait a while and then go, right, boom, this is it.
Yeah.
Dude, like, because you could do Wembley Stadium. You just need to do the kind of, like, this is it, Wembley Stadium, bang, have that night. F you, Chris Martin. Here I am.
I don't know about that. I mean, well, the thing about Keane is, I know Tim is, he would love it if we all were together and just doing it the whole time.
Yeah.
You know, that's how passionate he is about the band. don't get me wrong, I love Keane and I love everything that we've achieved and I still love doing it.
Yeah.
But I have to do it when it feels like there's the right energy there for it. Mm. Like, I think that's the thing, going back to the album, but there's that song Stars Align that you were mentioning. Mm. That is a song about going where the energy is. Well, great realizations I've had in life is it's much better to not have a big plan about the future and not 100%. Be sort of setting out with some great big goal in the distance. Because if you get there, you're probably going to be disappointed.
Yeah.
But to just be open to what might come in and what might happen. Mm. And however, you know, and to be willing to just take the odd left turn and do something that feels different, or just to go where it feels like, wow, that feels exciting, you know. And that was what it was with the last Keane album. It was like Tim had written some really kind of quite bleak, but they were the most vulnerable songs I'd ever heard him write. And I was like, that's what I want to be singing now.
Yeah.
You know, and it took the space of like a bit of a time when I was felt totally creatively blocked after my first solo album. So it's like, well, that's the right thing to do. I mean, I honestly don't know what the next move is.
Have you, excuse my ignorance, but have you done all of the first album tour?
No.
See, I think that's really creative, and it used to feel like a bad thing to do, but like if the Manics can do it, you could do it. So again, I feel like I've just joined the management team unpaid, but it gets back to me talking about, I think it's, people say, oh, it's an underrated album. It has its place. But as I said, it's stood the test of time. Yeah. That record's brilliant today. Would you get the creative enjoyment out of that? Like just going from track one to the end, Royal Albert Hall, like just for the friendship, just to go back as more evolved. You were kids, now you're not.
Yeah, yeah.
Like to go back and just feel that with those people who have been on that journey with you. I think that would be an interesting night, you know?
I'm sure it would be. I'm conflicted on it. Part of me does, as for all the reasons you've just outlined, I would like to do it. But also, part of me also feels like I'm a bit uncomfortable with looking back and kind of trying to recreate the past. But it's a question of, so it's a question of whether you can do that without it feeling like it's kind of heritage-y sort of revival of the old stuff. Funnily enough, I went to see David Gray playing White Ladder at the O2. And
so it's okay for you to go and see bands do it. How arrogant are these musicians?
The thing is,
David Gray, but not you. Yeah, well, precious.
Maybe I'm sort of proving a point to myself here, but I hadn't listened to White Ladder for a long time, and we were on holiday in Portugal earlier in the year, and my wife said, we should put White Ladder on. And I could not believe it is just from start to finish.
Great.
The most fantastic
record. In Ireland first, huge in Ireland.
Indeed, yes. Yeah. I got it first.
I was promoing it in Northern Ireland with David Gray in a car.
Right.
Believe it or not, one of my previous lives. Was it before it was even in Radio 1?
Yeah.
And that week was the week where Joe Wiley started playing it every day.
Right.
He'd get into the car on a Monday to go around Radio Foyle and, you know, BBC Northern Ireland and Cool FM and all the local stations. He'd get into the car on a Monday, fairly unknown outside of Dublin, and he'd get out of the car a superstar 4 days later.
Yeah.
That album sold in 2 weeks.
I'm not surprised.
Let go your heart, let go your
I love it when someone like David Gray, he just, you know, and I think this happened to Richard Ashcroft as well, just for a certain period of time, just utterly sort of surpassed everything you thought or they thought or whatever. And just, I don't know what it is. It's whether it's just the stars align or whether they tap into something just deeper and more profound or whether it just resonates more with people. I don't know what it is, but I just love that idea. There's a part of me that sort of, here we are, back to envy again, but there's a part of me that thinks, will that happen to me at some point with my songwriting? You know, will I suddenly elevate myself? Yeah.
That's so hard though.
Yeah. Right. You can't go set out with that intention.
There's some tremendous tracks in this album. It really is. Like, you should be so intensely proud and brave as well.
Well, maybe this is my White Ladder.
But like, I think there's only ever been 10 records ever maybe that didn't have a bad track.
Yeah.
Like, that's the holy grail. We were talking the other night about Definitely Maybe, 28th year anniversary, a couple of weeks ago. That don't have a bad track, you know.
Yeah.
It's strange. You look through 11, 12 tracks, you go, oh, God. Hopes and Fears isn't far off it. That's very close.
Yeah.
You know? I just put that idea for you, right? If it's good enough for David Gray, and he, look, why don't you message him and say, what did you get out of it? What did you not?
Yeah.
That could be a nice thing. Well, it based on what? Just for the day. Just what's going to make me happy now? What's going to make me content?
Yeah.
Forget all the perceptions. Who gives a about that, right?
Well, there's still a part of me. The self-loathing part of me cares about perceptions, definitely.
So, weird question, right? But as somebody who I think I'm in this position, do you feel you've grown into your face? do you get what I mean? It's like, because you look great, right? You really do, right? We didn't look great in our early 20s. We kind of weren't in our bodies, do you know what I mean? Like, I look at pictures now with my glasses and a cardigan on, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Whereas, like, you feel like it, like me, it took us longer. We had to hit 30 before we started to actually look like we were mental.
What
we
you're saying is we're in our prime.
We're in our prime, right?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
I do know exactly what you mean.
We are decent looking 40 somethings.
Yes, we are.
Right? But we weren't great in our early 20s.
We're fine wines, although we're not drinking any. But I don't know. Yeah, it's interesting that. I think partly that is also down to, like, your body is an extension. Well, your body is part of you, right? It's so if you've got a healthier mind, you can inhabit your body much more happily. And I think that comes across, right? My wife was saying that about, she said, oh, if you look at Thierry Henry, you can tell there's a man who's happy in his own skin.
Yes.
There's an ease to him.
Yes.
And I thought, oh yeah, she's right.
Yeah.
You know, there's a way, the way his sort of deportment, the way he sort of carries himself.
Yeah.
He's happy in his own skin. Oh yeah, I wouldn't mind a bit of that.
Yeah, he was certainly happy when he cheated against the Republic of Ireland in World Cup qualifying and
punched
the ball into the net, which he'll never be forgiven. I'm an Northern Ireland fan, but they're my neighbours and I will never forgive him for that. I want to ask you about some very random things to finish.
Sure.
What are you doing to find? Because I mean, I need solitude. That's the thing. If I don't get peace and quiet, I go crazy very quickly and I can get quite down. I don't know, there's something about silence that's just like a big warm blanket that you wrap around yourself. I noticed you, I don't fish myself.
Yeah.
But I noticed fishing is your thing. Like, off you go 3 days.
A week. I go to France for a week. I just love it. I mean, it is. I start smoking again. I end up smoking loads of cigarettes when I go fishing.
It's your little week of smoking and then back off. Secret fit. Do you have to mouthwash and stuff and wash the clothes so Natalie doesn't know you've had a pack of cigarettes?
No, she wouldn't.
You'll tell her?
Oh, yeah.
That level of honesty?
Wow. Oh, yeah, she wouldn't really care. She knows. She's seen so much worse that, you know, a few ciggies here and there is not going to bother her. I mean, what you say about solitude is true. Life with two small children, well, one is two and one is eight.
Yeah.
I mean, it is intense. Yeah. I mean, there's a 6-year age gap. The 2-year-old's come along. He is off the scale.
Yeah.
And has no concept of danger, but is very mobile. And then, you know, so juggling that and then trying to do Keane shows all summer.
Yeah.
And then trying to get this record ready. I need to go fishing.
Yeah.
I need
it. Get that break, that silence.
Yeah. I play golf, I go fishing, and I write songs. And I spend time at home and all of those things. That's all I need, really.
Yeah.
And that's genuinely.
That's what it is.
Yeah. And all that nothing, I learned one thing. We got something inescapable. Gravitation.
I've got to plug the dates, so go on the website, go and see you. What's the experience of not having Tim there, not having the band there when you walk out and it's not those people? Do you enjoy it?
Well, it was interesting, pros and cons, right? Keane had gone on a big... We'd gone on a hiatus. Or effectively, I said I didn't want to do it anymore, actually, is the truth of it, in 2013. So a lot of that time and the years following that was trying to find myself. And I think what I found with The Wave, the first solo album, was actually when I went out on stage, I could be myself.
Mm.
And I think maybe what I'd felt in Keane was a sense that I was being judged or whatever, which is probably not true, but that was my own insecurity.
Yeah.
And like, what the others think about what I'm saying, and I've got to be a certain way. So that wasn't very healthy, but I think doing the solo stuff allowed me to be much more myself, and that has now actually translated into Keane shows.
Mm.
I mean, still, nevertheless, going out and playing solo stuff because they're my songs. It's come right from the heart. You know, I'm the mouthpiece for my own feelings and my own experiences. Nothing can quite touch that. So it's still, yeah, I still love the feeling of walking out there to do my own.
Yeah. It's a bit more perilous, I suppose, isn't it? Just a little bit more like, there's no one else to blame here, right? And there's a moment when they first hear it live as well. It's like when you really learn what the... Those who bought the record, those who come and see it live, you go, okay, wow. So that's the track you connect to. Because musicians are terrible at knowing the best.
Yes, on their own, I agree with that wholeheartedly.
Always. I wouldn't even like to think what you wanted as singles on albums before because bands are terrible at it. But that moment where you go, oh my God, they're singing that lyric. Yeah. I think that is the true birth of a track is when you hear someone's mouth. You look at someone and they're singing that wrong and there's a tear or there's a smile.
Singing it wrong.
It's cheesy, but that's right.
No, I totally agree.
Yeah.
That's the great thing. They once they're out there, they've got their own life.
Yeah.
And you no longer control that.
Well, just finally, don't want to sound like your dad here. I'm only 2 years older, but like you have every reason now to enjoy it. You know, I realize that it's not a passive thing. The addiction, it's every day you wake up and go, I'm not going to use. But you do it for your kids. Mm. You're way too old to worry about what anyone bloody thinks, right? And you've got an album to be proud of, right? Yeah. I hope you can enjoy the experience without like, what does it sell? Who played it? Where are the gigs? How many?
Yeah.
You deserve this. Do you know what I mean? And your family deserve this. And I know it's difficult for you making the album. A lot of problems are when you're making an album.
Yeah.
But I hope you can truly enjoy this because
there
are parts of this album that are great. I mean, there's five or six tracks in this album that are great. So I hope you're really proud and I hope you can enjoy it in a way that maybe you didn't, you know, some of the earlier stuff.
Yeah. Thanks, mate. Yeah, I will try and do that. I think those traps, as the ones you pointed out, caring about what people think or, you know, where it's being played, they're easy to fall into. But actually, at the end of the day, all I want is just to be able to keep doing it.
Right.
So as long as I'm assured of that at the end of it, I'll be happy.
Susie Quattro said that to me recently on this show, I mean, the Queen of Rock. And she said, similar ups and downs. And she said, I've been doing this for 50 years. You tell me what success is. I make music all my life.
Yeah.
And I play to crowds all my life. That's the richest thing.
Yeah.
You know, and you're there. It's been too long now to worry it's going to go away, right?
Yeah. I hope so. Yeah, you never 100%. Know. You always feel like you've somehow you're winging it and that it might just all vanish in an instant.
It can't vanish because you can play Hopes and Fears from start to finish and give us what we want.
All right, it's a deal.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Colin.
Well, I hope that lived up to the billing that I gave at our Midnight Meets with Tom Chaplin from Keane and, of course, a solo artist as well. We spent a lot of that time talking about that new record. And, I have to be honest, not to overstate it, I really cherished that chat and I hope you did as well. The next one coming your way on your podcast feed will be another musician who goes way back. So Tim Burgess from The Charlatans will be talking to us about The Charlatans, about his solo records, about Tim Burgess's Twitter listening parties and all that. He's always a wonderful conversation. So that'll be your next Midnight Meets. Thanks for downloading.
BBC Sounds. Music, radio, podcasts.